This is an introduction to a series of talks that I'll be giving over the years, so there'll be lots of things in it that I'll be going into a lot more detail, doing longer talks, specific things. So this is a real mixture of lots and lots of elements that I think are important for us to think about. So if it's a bit jumbled up, excuse me, there is a logic to it. Okay. So first thing to think about is our school in particular. We've got a student body which is 40% Malaysian, so 50% local children here, 15% British, and the remaining 45% is from 55 different nations. So we are truly international, but we are quite heavily local as well. Now, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about what that might mean for your children and their cultural understanding. And what I would argue is that even the children that you have who are local and never lived anywhere else, they are affected by this school environment that they're in. So children that have lived in different places and have been influenced by different cultures, we call third culture children. Some of you might have heard me talk about that a little bit last week at the newcomers meeting. I will be doing a much longer talk on this in the new year, because it's a very, very important aspect of your child's lives, and there's lots and lots of research in this area that talks about the effect of living in different cultural environments on your kids. So welcome everybody. We've just been talking about the cultural makeup of our school. I'll just quickly go back so that you can see that we are 40% Malay and 15% British, and then 45% other cultures in our school. So we are an international school with quite heavy influence of the local population. As I was just about to say, the children that have lived in different places and been touched by other cultures that are not their parents' cultures, we call third culture children. So if you've lived in other places and are Malaysian and have come back, this refers to your kids. If you have, if you're not Malaysian and you have lived in different places, or you're from a different home country and you've come to live here, then your children are what's called third culture children. And they have a relationship with their home culture and also the cultures of the places that they're living in. I remember I emigrated with my family to Switzerland, different culture, different language, all of that, but at home it was like Little Britain. So they were touched by both cultures, because in their home you spoke English, you watched English television, listened to English radio, and obviously had lots of contact with the extended family. So they felt culturally British, but growing up in Switzerland they also felt an attachment to that culture as well. So influenced by both. Now, the research shows different things, that there are advantages and challenges of being a third culture child. So third culture children, they do develop adaptability. They've got a larger worldview, obviously. I don't think I was aware of what culture actually meant until I emigrated, because there were these differences that once I'd overcome language problems, I couldn't figure out why I didn't get these people. And they were not so different from me in some ways. They were European, they didn't come from the other side of the world, all these sort of things, but there were some fundamental differences that I couldn't put my finger on. What I realised was those were cultural. Your children are sensitised to that at a very, very young age. And it's almost a given that they understand that. It's an incredible advantage. Obviously, languages, there's much more emphasis on learning languages. Not just emphasis, but the reason for learning languages makes sense to them. You know, at school, in English schools, when we're trying to teach languages to kids, they don't often understand the point. They don't know why. Whereas your kids, as they are frequenting other children that speak different languages, they realise how important it is, and that motivates them. obviously it's exciting learning new environments and meeting new friends. They often seem more confident than kids that stay home, but we'll talk about that in a minute. They tend to be more creative in their thinking, be able to think in diverse ways. This is a finding of the research. They do very well academically. Most TCKs go on to do degrees, go to university. I think somebody was telling me that's not the same with TCKs that come from the army. Apparently they have less positive outcomes, but kids that have gone to international schools and that are global do very well academically. And they tend to live globally as adults, so they are not daunted by picking up, obviously, it's what they've grown up like it. You know, they're not daunted by picking up sticks and going and living wherever they need to follow the work. So these are all good things. The challenges, though, they quite often have identity issues. Who am I? I'm not, you know, my kids, I'm not British, I'm not Swiss, I'm not 100% English speaking, French speaking. Who am I? I'm a real mixer. I don't belong here, I don't belong there. This can cause ruthless and restless adults, in the sense that lots of TCKs go on in life to say that they don't really feel they fit anywhere, and they're always looking for another place to move on to. And if they don't, they're not satisfied, something's not going well, then they're looking for the next opportunity. Seeing this with my adult kids, I can see this. They don't feel that they're attached to either country, to Britain or to Switzerland. One lives in China and one lives in the UK at the moment, but I can see it with them. I can see it with a lot of the kids that grew up with my kids. They are all dispersed all over the world. And this can be an uncomfortable feeling, but it can be very positive, or it can be a very uncomfortable feeling for them. They have had to deal with lots of cycles of loss and separation. I think one of the things that's really, really important to know is that every time your child moves on, or every time their best friend moves on, because that's the nature of an international school as well, that not only will you be moving, but your children's classmates will be moving. And this is can be a very distressing thing for them. Because they get attached and then they have to break that attachment and move on. And when that happens regularly, sometimes they can get very defensive. So they don't want to go deep. They don't want to make a deep attachment. And what they found actually with third culture kids is they tend to go from here in a relationship to here very, very quickly. So they'll tell a person all about themselves, they'll disclose a lot, they'll be very, very friendly straight away. They might say, as a student said to me the other day, I've got a new best friend. They've only known them for 3 weeks. You know, this very, very typical. But after that point, they stick. They don't tend to move up. And we believe it's a lot to do with protecting themselves. They don't want to deepen that relationship any further, because that might have consequences if they leave. So they do that. That is something to be aware of, because one of the outcomes of the TCKs is there's more separation, divorce, and difficulty making attachments in their personal relationships. So it's something to be aware of. Now, all of these things, one of the reasons I'm telling you about all of this is the more aware we are, the more we can anticipate and the more we can mitigate against it. So if you see your child having this pattern of relationships, something you can be aware of, and you can encourage them to be more realistic. Okay. So what can you do? Important to acknowledge and name their feelings. So last week I was saying that with new students, if they get upset and they sort of say about that they, you know, that they're unhappy to be here, or they're missing their home, or they don't, you know, all of those things, we tend to jump in because we feel guilty and say, no, it's great, you've got a pool, you know, you can go here on holiday, look at this incredible environment you live in, all that sort of stuff. I would recommend you didn't do that, because that shuts them up. And they need to express this. They need to express feelings of sadness. And don't be scared of it, because it's really, really important that we express negative feelings as well as positive feelings. And one of the things that we teach children, and some of you came to my mindfulness talk last year, really, really important concept, is that your emotions are like weather. They're constantly changing. They might feel really down one minute, and then yes, oh, we've got a swimming pool, and we can go here and probably, but let them come up with that. So you fill in, try not to fill in for them, because that is, what message you're giving them is, I don't want to hear the negative stuff, I just want to hear the positive stuff, and then that's going to cause more difficulty and create baggage later on. One of the things that's really, really important, I think, is to create familiar environments wherever that they go, whether that be a physical environment, familiar photographs, toys, all that sort of stuff, and also familiar routines. It's really important to go back to the culture that you're from as regularly as you can, and to keep contact with your extended family. Okay. And acceptance is a very, very important concept. That we might, acceptance doesn't mean I like this and I'm putting up with it because, you know, it's good for me or anything like that. It's just to know, yeah, we have bad times, yes, it's difficult sometimes, but that's okay. We can feel that. It doesn't mean you don't need to panic about it, they don't need to panic about it. We can feel that, because later on we might feel differently. But for the moment, we can accept that we feel miserable or fed up about that. Okay, so what are our challenges as parents? So I'm going to, as I said to you earlier, that was a bit on the context of where we're from. I'm going to talk about lots of different elements and then go into more detail later on in the year on different subjects. And if anything comes up out of this talk and you feel like, well, I'd really like a lot more information about that, then please do step forward and let me know. And anytime you want to ask a question or anything like that, just shout out. We're going to very briefly look at the impact of technology. I think at pastoral staff, we see the impact of technology on the pastoral level quite a lot. So a lot of mistakes that the kids are making are technologically based, and we'll talk about some of that in a minute. How do you encourage good behaviour and good work habits? This talk is going to be, now you have the option of signing up to a parent classes after this. If you feel that you've got a lot of challenges bringing up your children at the moment and that you want some more specific advice, which is more tailored to your child's age range and everything like that, then we're going to be running some parent classes and you can sign up for a 6-week course, and I'll talk to you about that later. How do we ensure they're getting enough sleep? Last year I did a whole presentation on sleep. I don't know if anybody managed to come to that. It is a real bugbear of mine. It is so, so important. And actually, a colleague last night sent me an article from the newspaper talking about, and I'll add it to the resources, talking about the importance of sleep and showing the effects of, the long-term effects of short-changing yourself and the children on sleep. It is a problem in our school, it's not just this school, in the previous school I worked at as well. Students tend to feel, particularly when they're teenagers, that if they stay up all night and work, that they're doing the right thing. They're not, and I'll show you some things about that in a minute. Having realistic expectations for the child's developmental level, so obviously knowing what's appropriate for a child to be able to do at certain times. Very, very important that children at a young age have time for sleep, have time for play, have time to be bored. We tend to overschedule our children, thinking that that's the best thing for them. We know for their development that isn't. So we'll talk briefly about that. Encouraging after-school activities, but allowing time for education, for relaxation, also for social connection, for family time, all of those things. Really, really, really important for their emotional and social well-being. And I talked to you already about global transition. Okay, So here's a few questions for you, and I'm going to ask you just for a couple of minutes to turn to the person next to you and have a little discussion about it. How were you brought up? Do you think that you're the same sort of parent that your parents were? And how do you help your child adjust in different situations? How do you make sure they succeed? And what do you think about a child's happiness? And do you think that is your role to make them happy? And what other concerns or worries might you have? So have a couple of minutes to discuss with the people around you, and then we'll move on and I'll talk to you about some other things that I've come up with. Okay. Okay. Anything come up specifically? Did you I don't know if you started to be aware that there's lots of cultural differences as well in the way that you bring up the kids. And one, I do want to be culturally aware and sensitive whenever I do a talk like this. So I'm going to talk a bit about differences in Asian parenting styles and in Western parenting styles, and then see what we can come up with, because although we are predominantly Malaysian and we have a lot of other Asian nationalities here as well, it's a British school, so how does that work? And I see sometimes a conflict there, so and that's something we're going to talk about. So for Asian, a good Asian parent has a collectivist, the collectivist societies who care a lot about the community, they care a lot about extended family, care a lot about society, and that's very, very important rather than being all about me. Respect for authority is very, very important. Devotion to your parents, respect for your parents, very, very important. Emotional restraint, very important. You're not going to show all the time how you feel. People here are exceptionally polite to me, exceptionally polite. Even when I'm dealing with very difficult situations, delicate problems, never ever come across rudeness. I will not say that's the case from where I'm from. Where I'm from, people feel much freer to express their emotions, positive and negative. So it's much more challenging in some ways. But that doesn't mean you don't feel the same way. I'm interested in that and how we can express how we feel, even though it's impolite to do so. The importance of education, fundamental. That's why you're all paying so much money, I think, to send your children to this school. Very, very important. Discipline is used to protect and show love. It's not seen as a negative thing to discipline your child. Very involved in the child's life and with very high expectations of them as well. And the emphasis is on that. This is a really important distinction, I think, because you emphasize the importance of effort, right? You need to work really, really hard at something, and then you can be really good at something. And we see this with musicians, mathematicians, they just keep practicing until they get it. And that's why achievement in those areas is so, so high in Asian cultures, I'm convinced of that. And challenge is an opportunity and not an obstacle. So it's an opportunity to overcome it, not an obstacle. A good Western parent, quite different in many respects. Western societies are more individualistic. It's more, if there is a focus on the family, it's more the nuclear family, although we do care about our extended family. You can see this a little bit when we put our parents in homes rather than half of them. We tend to move for the job and all the rest of it. We don't tend to stay put. We're concerned about our own achievements. rather than the whole family's achievements, perhaps. I'm making big generalisations, but. We show support through physical affection, expression of what emotion and warmth. So much, like I said earlier, much higher expressed emotion than maybe in Asian societies. And we want the children to be independent rather than we're going to do much for them. The most important thing is that they can do it by themselves. A good Western parent will be keen to discuss things with their children. They will be keen to have some democracy in the home, so there is the children have a say in what goes on as well, but that everything's seen as fair. They will negotiate. I would say a bad Western parent negotiates too much, but there is some leeway in a good Western parent for negotiation with the child so that they feel that they have some say in the home. They have high expectations, the same, clear boundaries, but there's a margin of error. Rewards and consequences for bad behaviour. A good Western parent won't discipline their child physically or emotionally, won't shout at them, things like this. Lower power differentials in the sense that the child is not down here and the parent up here. More in the middle, and an emphasis on talent and natural ability. We tend to think in Western society that you're born good at certain things, and that what we need to do in education is find out what you're good at and then encourage that. Now, it's important for you to know that because I think most of your teachers come from Britain. So this is their culture, this is what they believe, and this is what you're seeing perhaps in the classroom. I think good teachers now understand that a lot of this repetition and practice and hard work is what gets you to be good and your natural ability to solution. So if we embrace both cultures, we focus on effort. The importance of failure, I don't know if some of you came to the talk that was given at the beginning of the school year about, the talk at the beginning of the year was on
growth mindset.
And in growth mindset, to have a growth mindset, it's really important sometimes to fail. And it's very, very important to accept failure and to overcome it. Resilience comes from failing several times, getting up, picking yourself up, keeping going. So really, really important to accept that. Not to prevent your children from failing by putting lots and lots of things by saving them all the time. So, for example, if they're struggling, jumping in immediately and getting them a tutor. Struggle is learning, and that's a very, very important thing that they're able to struggle through and come out the other side. Now, a real, real sense of achievement that they do. I remember a secondary student telling me that they got all A stars in their GCSEs and they'd done exceptionally well. And she said to me, but it wasn't me. I said, well, who was it? She said, well, I had five tutors and, you know, I had all these teachers, like, you know, giving me all this work and giving me extra this and extra that. And I don't feel I achieved anything. I think that's really sad. Well, she'd done so well, she'd worked so hard, but at the end of the day, she didn't feel she'd achieved anything because she felt she was given too much help. I think it's really, really important to get that balance right. Empathy and respect for others across both cultures. Independence. I do think this is important. Your children are going to come out of this system. A lot of them are going to be headed for places like the UK, America, wherever they're going to go, a very high level of independence is expected there. No one's even going to check if they turn up at college, if they go to their lectures. As long as they're handing their work, no one's going to check where they are, all that sort of stuff. So they need to learn from a young age, I think, that they need someone on their own to be responsible for themselves. and for both cultures to reject physical and psychological punishment. I know that you all care deeply about your kids, that's why you're here today, and that's why you're sending them to this school. So, punishment, physical, emotional, is a no-no, because it really, really will damage your child, and we'll talk about that in a minute, because we have a zero tolerance policy in the BSKL to physical punishment, and it's important that you know where we're coming from. So, how do you see your role as a parent? I'm going to ask you to have a chat about this in a minute. Are you overly concerned with your child's achievements? I know I was. I mean, I definitely was over-parenting. I was more concerned about their grades than they were. When my son didn't get into that top university, I felt it really personally. And if I wasn't going to that university, that was him. And he put me right about that, you know. And went on to do fine. But I took it as a personal blow, which is ridiculous, actually. But I think we do. We invest so much. And it's almost like their successes are our successes, that as it's our job to bring them up, it shows whether we've done a good job or not in how successful they are. And that's dangerous because, you know, their child, that puts an awful lot of pressure on them. And it's like we're living through them as well. So we've got to be careful about it. Do you see your role as a protective one? And how do you react if they make mistakes or fail? What do you do? So just have a little chat with the person next to you about those things. Okay. I'm sorry to interrupt, but it looks like some interesting discussions going on. And I really encourage you to keep talking to each other as well, because you are the people, you know, you're a core group of people. If you also go out and talk to anybody you can meet, transfer some of these messages, you're helping me enormously. Because what we need are really, I think we agree on, the SLT and I agree on, is a culture that is agreed. I mean, we're all going to be very different, but there are certain things that we will agree on. For example, I'll go back in a minute. We were discussing this recently in our meeting, that, you know, this is something that we agree on, which is the United Nations Convention of the Rights of the Child. And I've taken three articles just as examples, but the whole of the United Nations Convention, obviously we agree with. In British school, this is the sort of international law that we agree with. So, Article 19 is to protect the child from abuse and neglect. So we have zero tolerance at our school of physical punishment. Now, that does happen regularly, and we know it. And sometimes we find out about it, and then we ask the parents to come in. We're not being judgmental. We just believe it doesn't work, and I'll talk to you about those things in a minute. And that it's abusive and causes a lot of problems. So if that does happen, we hear about it, we will ask you in. What we try and do is help you to find alternatives, because some children are very, very difficult to manage. This I do know, and we had one of those. I'm glad for two. One was dreadful. One. And still is. And Article 9 is to respect their views. We take this very, very seriously, and we listen to your children and their opinions and their views, and I think that's an important part of the household culture. And Article 29, that the goals of education are to develop every child's personality, talents and abilities, and as well as encouraging their respect for human rights, their own rights, and the cultures, other cultures and the environment. Very, very important, and it's embedded into all of our work at BSKL. So this is where we're coming from. This is the philosophy that we're coming from. So, talking about over-parenting, so I asked you some questions here could you be open parenting? What does that look like? Well, it looks like this, and I can hand my, right, the first one I've done, dressing a preschool child instead of letting them practice for themselves. Especially when I was trying to get out to work, and then putting this on that, on their tires, and this, that, and the other, I would jump in and do that for them. I think as much as we can, somebody said, I think it was an Adlerian psychologist said to me, whatever a child can do for themselves, can do for themselves, even if it's not very well, it doesn't matter about that, they should do for themselves. And I was a terrible parent because I picked up after my teenage son telling all sorts of things that I shouldn't have done. And it's their girlfriends that are paying the price for it. So. But I feel, I wish I'd known this stuff then. But really, as much as possible, give them tasks to do, let them do it themselves. If they can do it, let them do it. Wake up school-aged kids instead of using an alarm. Teenagers are notoriously impossible to wake up. So, but they should do it themselves. A consequence being they miss the school bus if they do, and they get into a terrible state about it and they get really angry. So be it. They won't do it again. You know, they need, these things are really, really important. Nagging about homework instead of encouraging them to use a planner and a schedule. You know, again, what have you got for homework? Sit down, let me see your planner, let me sit, you know. No, if they forget their homework and they get into trouble, that's their trouble. It's not your responsibility. I think in British school, we would say these are all really, really important aspects, and it's all about that independence that we're trying to encourage. So, really, really important. And then some parents, I have done this once, even do their children's homework. Guilty. If they, homework means work you can do at home on your own. If they can't do it, then they should be going into the teacher and saying, look, sorry, this is impossible. And then the teacher will say, well, why didn't you listen to lessons then? It's trying to take responsibility. But no, if they can't do it, they have to take responsibility to figure out how to do it. It's really, really important. I don't think any teacher would give them something they couldn't possibly do. So don't do the homework for them. This is a big one in our school. A bit of a bugbear of mine, when you think of what I said earlier about that child who said, oh yeah, but it's not my achievement. If you engage, I had a student the other day came to see me, and I said, well, what about that lesson? And he said, no, it's fine. He said, because he was messing about in lessons. I wasn't listening. I said, right, so how's that going to work? And you go home and you've got your homework to do. But it doesn't matter because I'm going to do it all again with my tutor. So there are kids who are not listening properly in class, not getting the best advantage that they can out of this school. Because, you know, it should be enough. This should be enough. The teachers are really good. The system's really good. It should be enough. They shouldn't need repetition and practice with tutor at home when they go home. Should need that. So if they do need that, if they have specific learning difficulties, obviously that might be helpful. But they don't systematically need it. And I see our kids being over-tutored, and that is a problem for their independence. So beware of that. And worrying about their future more than they do. I mean, if you are spending more time thinking about your child's future than you are about what your next career move is, or whatever it is, then that's the problem. They will get there, with or without you. But you can sometimes invest too much in their lives instead of letting them get on with it. So, coming on to discipline, how were you disciplined as a child? And do you struggle at times getting your child to cooperate? So I'll give you 2 minutes to think about that. And how do you manage your child's behaviour? Because we all have difficulties, believe me. We all have difficulties getting our children to cooperate at times. And with disrespect and all the other things that provoke us. How do you get them to cooperate? And what difficulties do you have with them? Okay, I'm sure you've realised already, this is it's one of the most difficult areas of bringing up children. And we've all got different ideas, and we've all been brought up differently. I know that when I was growing up, I got hit, you know, that was okay, you know, in those, well, it wasn't okay, but it was what happened. But then, when I had my own children, it was much less socially accessible. And I had to really try hard to find other ways. I don't want, because of what we said about us not being opposed to physical punishment, and that we are under the United Nations Convention, all those sort of things, to say, look, let's not discuss this. It's really, really important to discuss it and not brush it under the carpet, I think, because a lot of us have challenges. I did have a parent who did hit her child. I had a discussion with her. She emailed me and said, look, she's done it again, like really very, 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 very extreme behaviour. And but I did hit her, she's grounded. That was a fantastic achievement for her, because she really was provoked to the nth degree. It's a struggle. We will talk to you about it, but it's an important thing to understand that corporal punishment is humiliating and degrading. And we'll talk about the effects of it in a minute, because kids will get revenge on you, unfortunately, if you do this to them. And non-physical can be equally damaging. That means anything that degrades them, makes them feel small, makes them feel bad as a person, anything like ostracising them, ignoring them, things like that, really, really damaging. So I have kids who remember years back about, you know, an incident of this. Years back, it marks them. So we get really provoked, and I encourage you to practice. If any of you came to the mindfulness talk, I encourage you to develop mindfulness, because sometimes you need to step away from your own emotions in the moment, just stand back a bit from them, not react, because it just gets into a cycle and we do things and say things that we wish we hadn't done too long. So the effects of punishment, there is a stress response. So basically, when you get highly stressed, you cannot hear. So they can't hear what you're saying to them. So actually screaming and shouting in the moment when it's already a stressful situation is absolutely pointless, because they can't process what you're saying. It damages the relationship that you have with the child, and it makes them resentful and angry. And like I said, most kids will get revenge on you somehow. Either they'll stop talking to you, they'll hide behaviour. Children that have been hit, I know, they still carry on with the same behaviour, but they just get more sneaky about it. They stop engaging with you. It reduces their self-esteem and dignity. It escalates, so you hit them once, they get used to it. And then how hard do you have to hit them next time, the next time, the next time. And it encourages and condones violence. It says, when there's a problem, this is the way to deal with it, we're going to hit. And obviously, we don't want kids to learn that. And I talked about how they will avoid punishment by sneaking around and doing and not telling you what they're up to. And I see that a lot. The kids who are hit I have a lot of screaming, shouting, things going on at home. They develop secretive ways of doing what they want to do anyway. So, in the parents' workshops that we will be running, we will be focusing on a different way of disciplining children, using positive discipline principles. So, underlying it is the idea that if a child misbehaves, they're discouraged in some way. Because a child, like every child, no matter the most acting out child, I think this is something, as a pastoral team, sometimes we need to remember, every child wants to belong. And it might look that like the opposite, because they're doing crazy things that, you know, but it's because they're mistaken in the way to belong, if you like. So a child who's really acting out and being very, very difficult, they assume that is the way that they're going to get the right attention that they want, and they're going to fit into their social group. So they need to, there needs to be some learning there. And their primary goal is to belong to you, to your family. So if they're shouting and screaming at you, it's worth bearing in mind that that's the case. They want to feel secure, they want to belong. And when they're stressed, they might not look like it, but that is really what they want. So positive discipline focuses on solutions instead of consequences. So you come up with them together. So if this happens, what are we going to do about it together? They know in advance. And there may be consequences, but that's okay. But they're really in advance, and they know what's going to happen. How can we prevent you from doing these things? How can we prevent you from not doing your homework? What solutions can we put in place? So we're going to go into lots more detail about that. Positive discipline encourages kids, because it's the opposite of discouragement. That's what creates bad behaviour. It encourages them to think about their behaviour in a positive way. It encourages democracy. So we are negotiating with them. They're not in charge. This is all within boundaries. They're not in charge. We're still running the show, but that we will. They are allowed a say, and they are allowed a vote on things. And mindful awareness of our own emotions and their emotions as well, so to develop that. And take time for training. So training their behaviour in different ways and training them up the different tasks that they need to do in the house, not expecting them to be able to do it without having some training in the first place. And teaching and modelling mutual respect. So if you don't want them to speak badly to you, you don't speak badly to them. It's not that we're here, we can say what we like, and you're down there, and we expect you just to be polite for children. No, we're going to model that, what does it look like both ways. Okay, so sleep. There's some sleepy people in the audience. I think that we all don't have enough sleep, so the children really are not getting enough sleep. So the amount that you need decreases with age, but school-aged children, they need between 10 to 11 hours, and teenagers need 9 to 9.5 hours. Now, if you think how much sleep your child got last night, if they're a teenager, they were getting up at 6:30, they needed to be asleep by what, 10? 10-ish? To get 9, 9.5? 10. And I know there were kids in the secondary who walked through the door this morning and went to bed at 2. So I'm quite a liberal parent, very liberal, but one thing that I did not give up on until they left home at 18 was pulling all the plugs out, taking all the technology out of the room at 10 o'clock, lights out, go to sleep now, until they were 18. And that might be called over-parenting. Maybe it was over-parenting. But I just feel it's our responsibility to make sure they get enough sleep. There was an article, in The Guardian that a colleague sent me last night. There's been a new book, some research done on sleep, the effects of not having enough sleep, long-term, short-term, and it has terrible long-term physical, psychological effects if you don't get enough sleep. So he's saying, in terms of public health, this should be a priority of making sure that we have good sleep hygiene. I'm going to do much more on this in the next talk, so please do come along. But very briefly, the consequences of not getting enough sleep. Your long-term memory is compromised. When you sleep, you fail. So kids don't learn if they don't sleep. If they don't sleep, basically, all the learning that happened that day, you might as well forget it. They have filed it away. So a child who thinks that they're doing a good student by staying up all night studying is wrong. They're not. They're doing the opposite. They're unlearning. So we need to make sure they get to sleep. Mood regulation, much greater risk. You know yourself, if you've not slept enough, you over-dramatize, you feel miserable, you feel depressed. Same with kids. Concentration, their ability to focus during the day will decrease if they haven't got enough sleep. So has a knock-on effect. They can't even, so they didn't learn the night before because they didn't sleep, and the day that they go into school they don't learn because they can't concentrate. Their metabolism, obesity, childhood obesity, we think now is massively impacted. not childhood, but the whole obesity phenomenon is impacted by less and less sleep. And that's a very sophisticated relationship with hormones coming online and things like that when you're actually in deep sleep. So there's lots and lots of evidence now that this is the connection. So if you want your child to be fit and healthy, not put on weight, they need to sleep enough. Their growth hormones come online when they're asleep as well. So again, very, very important. And the immune system is reinforced when they're asleep. All these important functions happen when they're asleep. So please make it your biggest priority as a parent to make sure they get enough sleep. And technology impacts phenomenally on this. You've got the screens that emit blue light, which interfere with your serotonin levels. Your serotonin is the important sleep hormone. It gets switched off. Well, it won't, no. It will switch on when it's dark. But when you're in front of the screen, or be it a telephone, a computer, whatever it is, television, it doesn't allow it, this process to happen. So they need to be off their technology at least an hour before they go to sleep. So, yeah. So, right. And then just briefly on technology. Kids, you know, we call it the Wild West, the internet, because no one is policing it. No one is watching what they're doing. We've got very young children accessing pornography. We've got sexting going on. Does everyone know what that means? You know, where inappropriate images are sent between mobile phones, this, that, and the other, and once it gets out there, it can be sent on to other people. Kids are doing all sorts of things that maybe they could have done in real time, but now they're doing in virtual time, and then there's a footprint attached to that. We know that kids are vulnerable to depression if they're constantly comparing themselves on social media. And my friends recently, I joined Facebook recently after many years not being on it, because I've been to Kuala and I thought they would want to see what I'm up to. They think I'm having this incredible existence and that I look amazing. Well, I'm not going to put a horrible photograph of myself on Facebook. You know, and it's the same with kids. They don't put anything negative about themselves on Facebook. Or that awful photograph with the wrong angle and where they look really good. They're not. So our kids are comparing themselves with unrealistic images of others. And it can cause a lot of depression, especially in girls, actually. Cyberbullying. We used to get bullied at school, go home, and then be free of it until the next day. Now it's 24/7. The bullies can get at you anyway. If anything like that comes up, please do let us know. Divulging. We need to teach our kids not to put all of themselves out there. We get exasperated at the end of the school, their school life, because kids have put some really, really out there things on their social media, and that can be accessed by colleges, that can be accessed by workplaces later on and everything. We need to teach our children that this is, you need to be really careful, it doesn't disappear. And there are companies now that can find out all your history, so if they really want to find out about your history. Gaming addiction, particularly in boys, is a big thing. Gaming addiction, in some ways it's sort of like a mindful thing because they're totally absorbed in it and they're not thinking about their problems and their difficulties. And that's why a lot of kids get hooked on it. Just watch that. If you think it's an issue, find out why it's an issue. You may need to, come to a solution with them and talk to them about the amount of time they're spending on their games. And then also, by hurting others on games, there's sometimes that can be a desensitizing and they get a positive feeling from hurting. That's not necessarily what we want to encourage. Okay, we talked a lot about all sorts of things, and there are some good practices in terms of how you talk to your children and about their well-being. We'll be visiting these things in our parent talks and later on in the year in different talks that I do. Just know that sad, difficult feelings, they often have a very important purpose. So if you feel anxious, it's a warning sign that everything's not going right and you need to address it. If you feel sad, it's because you've lost. To feel attachment and feel love for somebody means that you miss pain. And we need to teach our kids, it's a price worth paying. So, but we can feel these difficult feelings, and we don't need to protect our kids from them. In fact, it's important that we don't. If we feel anger, it's because someone's trespassing on us in some way. We need to be able to deal with that, and we need to step back and deal with it appropriately. So these are important emotions that they need to feel, and I don't think we should be protecting them from them. They need to experience difficulty and failure. I've talked about that, so important. That is how they become resilient. The more struggle they have at school, to be honest, the better. I worry about those kids who are extremely off the scale in terms of ability, that it just comes quick, because when they reach a challenge or a difficulty in life, they find it very difficult to cope. You see the kids who have lots of challenge doing very well in difficult situations. So we need to encourage some of this. If your child knows what they care about and what they believe in, has good value system, and so do you, and that as much as possible try to follow this, this is how they're going to feel good in life, and this is how they're going to feel. Even when everybody else around them is doing the wrong thing, they can stick to what they believe in. That's very, very important. We all fall off it sometimes, but it's very important. And to be aware, we're teaching mindfulness across the primary school, and we're also addressing it in the secondary school. The more we're aware of our own emotions, the better, and the more we can stand back and then decide, how are we going to behave? Even though I feel like this, how am I going to behave? In line with my values. Knowing your character strengths and using them, very, very important. And I'll put a link on the bottom that you can do a survey to find out what your children's character strengths are and yours are. Very important. Positivity and gratitude, these make us resilient and make us happier in life. So bringing up to mind 10 things I'm grateful for on a daily basis with your child, really, really important. Starting a positivity journal so they think of 3 things every night that went well. Start to switch it around. We're very negative. Human beings are very, very negative. So the more we can try and train our bright brains to think in a more positive way, the better. Okay, so we're going to finish now, but up to upcoming talks, we're going to have helping your child reach their full potential. I'll be going into much more detail on the effects of sleep and some other aspects as to how we can make our children as resilient as possible and as high achieving as possible. And I don't just mean the academic realm. Because if they're feeling really, really solid emotionally, socially, they're going to do well academically. They're going to do as well as they can. So we're going to be talking much more about that. And then next year, we're going to be doing a longer session on what it really means to be a third culture child. And I'll be sharing a lot of research about that with you. And then we have time for another one. So if anybody has anything particular they want me to talk about, that's fine. Otherwise, something will come up. If you want to sign up for the parent classes, we will put that in the newsletter soon, a Google Doc for you to sign up. So it will be a small group. We won't take more than probably 12, which I think. It will be a 6 session on probably, I think it's a Monday afternoon at 2 o'clock. And we'll be teaching you lots of different aspects of what I've talked to you about. And we will be going in specifically into parenting skills that you can use. So we'll include all this in the newsletter. So basically, you can sign up. Okay. Has anybody got any questions or anything they want to say before we finish? Sorry, I haven't been particularly interactive, but I wanted to get lots of different things.
Can I just say a big thank you to Claire Ireland. Parenting, as I know from experience, can be challenging but extremely rewarding. So thank you for your support today and well done to you.